Yeah. A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helpmate." So, from the soil, the Lord God fashioned all the wild beasts and all the birds of heaven. These he brought to the man to see what he would call them. Each one was to bear the name the man had given it. The man gave the names to all the cattle, all the birds of heaven, and all the wild beasts. But no helpmate suitable for man was found for him. So the Lord God made the man fall into a deep sleep. And while he slept, he took one of the ribs and enclosed it in flesh. The Lord God built the rib he had taken from the man into woman and brought her to the man. The man exclaimed, "This at last is bone from my bones and flesh from my flesh. This is to be called woman, for this was taken from man. This is why a man leaves his father and mother and joins himself to his wife, and they become one body."
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise always on my lips. In the Lord my soul shall make its boast. The humble shall hear and be glad.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Think of God's mercy, my brothers, and worship him, I beg you, in a way that is worthy of thinking beings, by offering your living bodies as a holy sacrifice, truly pleasing to God. Do not model yourselves on the behavior of the world around you, but let your behavior change, modeled by your new mind. This is the only way to discover the will of God and to know what is good, what it is that God wants, what is the perfect thing to do. Do not let your love be a pretense, but sincerely prefer good to evil. Love each other as much as brothers should, and have profound respect for each other. Work for the Lord with untiring effort and with great earnestness of spirit. If you have hope, this will make you cheerful. Do not give up if trials come, and keep on praying. If any of the saints are in need, you must share with them, and you should make hospitality your special care. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. As I stand to read the gospel.
Changed, how they've grown in love. Okay, But you know, all that has got more to do with the Beatitudes than you might think. The Beatitudes word means blessing, doesn't it? Ways of receiving gifts from God, ways of measuring up to the gospel, ways of learning what it means to be truly human and truly Christian, ways of becoming closer to that image of holiness that God wants for each one of us. And in the middle of the Beatitudes is a way for Stephanie and George together. Indeed, in the Beatitudes is a way for each one of us. Each of us has a special vocation, a special way of holiness. That's why there are eight Beatitudes. We don't all have to be human or Christian in exactly the same way. So how is that to be applied to marriage? Many years ago, I used to act as a sort of chaplain to a small group of married couples who would meet every month to talk together about their lives. It was very impressive and very edifying, in a very good sense, to listen to people talking honestly about their lives, about the highs and lows, the joys and the problems. And the rule was that to prepare for meeting, they would sit down together, each couple, and before the meeting, pray and talk together. Once a month. Not a bad practice, you might think about it. Then, the meeting. They'd all take turns to speak. And every now and then, one would make a bit of a confession that I could see took the partner a little bit by surprise. And I noticed a look of alarm on the other one's face. We agreed not to talk about that, being safe. Marriage is nothing if not a negotiation between two people. It's much more than that, of course. A phrase that constantly reverberated around those meetings. I don't know where it came from. It just seemed to sum up something of what people were aspiring to. We are couples, not married singles. Couples, not married singles. Now that little phrase could have come from the book of Genesis, that reading we've listened to. God looks at Adam. Adam is the human person. God looks at Adam and says, it's not good for the human person to be alone. And in creating a partner, God isn't creating a subordinate, a lesser creature who can do the dominant one's bidding. God is producing, this is the deep meaning of that, God is producing a difference within creation, within the single Adam. Everything God makes is, in an important sense, difference, set apart, yet held together within a single greater unity. In other words, each one of us is called to be uniquely ourselves, yet we can only become ourselves in partnership with each other and working together with each other. Very simply, George is George. George, you are George. Stephanie is Stephanie. You are Stephanie. You don't deal with that. Yet what they pledge today is to become that very special example, sacrament indeed, of Adam, of God's creation, to a life of intimate relationship with each other. Not married singles, not a convenient way of just pursuing our own individual interests and independence, but couples, witnessing to that complex unity of creation. That's the miracle. That's the miracle which we celebrate today. A miracle of how all of us, different examples of Adam, bring something new and special to grow and transform our world. That's what all of us do. That's what we witness today with this young couple pledging themselves to each other to bring about something of the harmony of God's creation. So go back to the Beatitudes. It needs a number of ways of relating to each other, of becoming more truly ourselves, of doing it together. Sometimes it'll mean being meek. Sometimes it'll mean being a peacemaker. Sometimes it'll entail mourning for loss. Sometimes it means standing up for what you believe to be true, for justice. But the key is learning to practice these virtues of human living as a couple. In practice, a great deal of learning has to go on. As you listen to these Beatitudes, you decide which one is right for you at this moment, what really encapsulates something for you and your life. A great deal of learning has to go on about what I am as this particular manifestation of Adam, God's creation. And you do that together, learning how my partner copes with fears and anxieties, celebrates joys and successes, grieves over loss and separation. Final thought. Few verses before that Genesis passage, there's a reference to the Garden of Eden. It's idyllic. It's perfect. It's full of beauty. It's today. And from the garden arises a river which divides, says the writer, into four branches which flow out into the world, giving life to the whole of creation. And perhaps that little image is symbolic of how a single life, a single source of God's energy flows out into the world in a number of different ways. We're not all called to be the same. God's creation is not uniform in that sense. But we are called to work with whatever we have for a greater sense of the unity and harmony of creation. Now, whether the river is the great Thames, or whether the river is the Orwell, or some little brook babbling through some different countryside, when rivers come together and meet, there's a degree of turbulence. Flow is never perfect. That's what makes the rivers, that's what makes life so interesting. But gradually, the flow of those rivers settles down to something deep and wonderful. And something deep and wonderful can grow if you learn those virtues of how to live your lives together. Stephanie and George, what you're doing today is savoring for the first time how wonderful and life-giving your partnership can be. Who knows what joys and these sorrows there will be for you in the years to come. And our prayer, my prayer, at this moment is simply that in 50 years' time, you'll look back and remember not what anyone in particular said, the speech is still to come, my few words now, but what you now say to each other, that promise to grow together through the inevitable turbulence that will come into something where the great virtues which God bestows on you can truly flourish.
Stephanie and George, you have come together into the house of the church, so that in the presence of the church's minister and this Christian community, you may state your intention to enter into marriage, and that your intention may be strengthened by the Lord with a sacred seal. Christ abundantly blesses the love that binds you. Through a special sacrament, he enriches and strengthens those he has already consecrated by holy baptism, that they may be faithful to each other forever and assume all the responsibilities of married life. And so now, in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intentions. George and Stephanie, have you come here to enter into marriage without coercion, freely and wholeheartedly?
I have.
George, are you resolved to take Stephanie to be your wife, to love her, comfort her, honour and protect her, and forsaking all others, to be faithful to her as long as you both shall live?
I am.
Stephanie, are you resolved to take George to be your husband, to love him, comfort him, honour and protect him, and forsaking all others, to be faithful to him as long as you both shall live?
I am.
Are you prepared to accept children lovingly from God and to bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church?
I am.
I do solemnly declare.
I do solemnly declare.
That I know not.
That I know not.
Of any lawful impediment.
Of any lawful impediment.
Why I, George William Holder.
Why I, George William Holder.
May not be joined in matrimony.
May not be joined in matrimony.
To Stephanie Maria Barnes.
To Stephanie Maria Barnes.
I do solemnly declare.
I do solemnly declare.
That I know not.
That I know not.
Of any lawful impediment.
Of any lawful impediment.
Why I, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
Why I, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
May not be joined in matrimony.
May not be joined in matrimony.
To George William Holder.
To George William.
George and Stephanie, since it is your intention to enter the covenant of holy matrimony, I now ask you to join your right hands. I call upon these persons here present.
I call upon these persons here present.
To witness that I, George William Holder.
To witness that I, George William Holder.
Do take thee, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
Do take thee, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
To be my lawful wedded wife.
Be my lawful wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
This day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
Love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
I call upon these persons here present.
I call upon these persons here present.
To witness that I, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
To witness that I, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
Do take thee, George William Holder.
Do take thee, George William Holder.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
May the Lord, in his kindness, strengthen the consent you have declared. What joins together, let no one put asunder. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Bless these rings, which you will give to each other as a sign of your love and fidelity. Just to make sure.
Stephanie, I give you this ring.
Stephanie, I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
With my body, I love you.
My body, I love you.
All that I am, I give to you.
All that I am, I give to you.
And all that I have, I share with you.
All that I have, I share with you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
George, I give you this ring.
George, I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
With my body, I honor you.
With my body, I honor you.
All that I am, I give to you.
All that I am, I give to you.
And all that I have, I share with you.
And all that I have, I share with you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy
Spirit.
As we Chloe will now lead us in the prayer of the faithful. Dear brothers and sisters, as we call to mind the special gift of grace and charity by which God has been pleased to crown and consecrate the love of our sister Stephanie and our brother George, let us now commend them to Almighty God.
We pray for George and Stephanie that their life together will be filled with love, joy, and laughter, and that they may always be true friends to each other. May the Lord who brought them to this happy day keep them forever in fidelity and love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
By this marriage, two families have been united. May both families continue to be a source of love, support, and guidance through George and Stephanie's life. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the leaders of the Church, for Francis our Pope, Alan our Bishop, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they will lead the Church with faith, hope, and love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the leaders of nations, that they will follow the example of Christ and lead with love, mercy, and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all those who are sick, suffering, or in danger, that they will experience the healing power of Christ's love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all married persons, strength to love their spouses as Christ loves us, that each day their relationship will grow and deepen through kindness and prudence. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially the departed friends and relatives of those gathered here today, may God unite us again in the joys of our eternal home. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In silence, we pray to God, our Father, for our own special intentions.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
Graciously pour out upon this husband and wife, O Lord, the spirit of love, to make them one heart and one soul, so that nothing whatever may divide those you have joined, and no harm come to those you have filled with your blessing, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Mr. and Mrs. Holder, Mr. and Mrs. Holder Senior, Mr. and Mrs. Holder, sort of Senior, we're now going to go into the sacristy to sign these civil registers. In the meantime, we'll all sit down and we will listen to Ross.
Thank you. drop that.
Of bread and wine brought forward to the altar, we will sing our next hymn, Brother, Let Me Be Your Servant, which you can find on page 8 of the Orders of Mass. John. Guide its course through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For in him you have made a new covenant with your people, so that, as you have redeemed man and woman by the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, so in Christ you might make them partakers of divine nature and joint heirs with him of heavenly glory. In the union of husband and wife, you give a sign of Christ's loving gift of grace, so that the sacrament we celebrate might draw us back more deeply into the wondrous design of your love. And so with all the angels and all the saints, we praise you, and without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
By reconciliation, we pray, Lord, advance the peace
and salvation of all women. Be pleased to confirm in faith the charity your filial church on earth with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. Amen.
Let us stand now as at the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Let us pray to the Lord for this bride and groom, who come to the altar as they begin their married life, that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, they may always be bound together by love for one another. Holy Father, who formed man in your own image, male and female you created them, so that as husband and wife, united in body and heart, they might fulfill their calling in the world. O God, who to reveal the great design you formed in your love, willed that the love of spouses for each other should foreshadow the covenant you graciously made with your people, so that by fulfillment of the sacramental sign, the mystical marriage of Christ with his church might become manifest in the union of husband and wife among your faithful. Graciously stretch out your right hand over these your servants, Stephanie and George, we pray, and pour into their hearts the power of the Holy Spirit. Grant, O Lord, that as they enter upon this sacramental union, they may share with one another the gifts of your love, and by being for each other a sign of your presence, become one heart and one mind. May they also sustain, O Lord, by their deeds, the home they are called, and prepare their children to become members of your heavenly household by raising them in the way of the gospel. Graciously crown with your blessings your daughter Stephanie, Lord, so that by being a good wife and a good mother, she may bring warmth to her home with a love that is pure and adorn it with welcoming graciousness. Bestow a heavenly blessing also, O Lord, on George, your servant, that he may be a worthy, good, and faithful husband and a provident father. Grant, Holy Father, that desiring to approach your table as a couple joined in marriage in your presence, they may one day have the joy of taking part in your great banquet in heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. It's going to be good.
Sing like never before, oh my Look at me, that's it, there's one, we're going to do one more, we're going to do one more, that's it. You can give each other a very gentle kiss, please.
Perfect, hold on, do you want to go and hop?
We're going to hide for a minute around the side.
Oh!
I need you to make two lines, please. If I can have one line down here.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Right, two lines.
Yes, this is kind of stand right there.
Can you read the line?
All right, I'll throw it.
I see.
Yay, very hard.
Oh, thank you.
The opportunist.
Are you in the film? No. Turn it around.
I am with Catherine.
Hey, cousin!
And Elizabeth.
Hey.
And our flowers.
And the flowers. And look, I really was at the wedding. sun is shining on you.
Hello, tell me.
Son of the righteous, eh?
Hello. Hey, hello. Congratulations. Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
Hello. Hi, Dad.
I think so, yeah.
Thank you.
to be, and I will always need love here and road.
It's a beautiful venue.
It is a fantastic venue, and Linda's worked so very, very, very hard, and with modesty and love. And well done, well done.
Give.
And all we've had to do is turn up and eat, so that's got to be bad.
And not trying to touch hands.
That's the hardest thing.
I'm going to the flight into Milan, and I'm going to go across to Venice, and then down to Florence, and then Assisi, and then Rome, and then Naples at the end.
That sounds wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm really excited for that. Yeah.
When are you going? When are you going straight away?
Pretty much, yeah. So we're going on Monday. So.
Oh my goodness, wow, quick turnaround.
Yeah. Yeah, when you've only got like a short amount of annual leave, you've got to make the most
of it.
Scarves of red tied round their throats to
keep their little heads from falling in the snow. And I turn around and there you go. And Michael, you would fall and turn the white snow red as strawberries in summer.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us together this day to celebrate George and Stephanie's wedding. We ask you to bless us, bless them, bless their family and friends and all who love them. Bless the food that we share, the entertainment that we enjoy, and grant food to the hungry. This we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Bon appetit.
Father of the bride, Paul Barnes.
As you all know by now, I am Stephanie's dad. I want to start by thanking all of you for being such wonderful guests at Stephanie and George's wedding. Thank you, Hilda and Jonathan, for your support in making this a lovely occasion and come together, for being so kind to Stephanie from the moment you met her. Thank you, Linda, for working away in the background, helping Stephanie and George to plan the wedding for their personal touches.
Yes.
Now I want to welcome George officially into our family, but really this is just a final step along the journey that began when he and Stephanie met in 2012. We met him for the first time that Christmas and liked him straight away. He has impressed me ever since with his gifts, including the time when he bought me a drone. Now on to Stephanie. She is a wonderful daughter, a nagging but loyal sister to Sarah, a caring friend and a loving godmother to Andrew.
Aww.
She's always a busy little girl who announced at the age of 5 that she wanted to become a teacher.
Aww.
Linda and I are delighted that she finally reached this goal with George at her side.
Yeah.
As for being a busy girl, she never stopped talking. and often didn't pay attention to what she was doing. This all came together one lunchtime at Pin Mill, here in Suffolk. She awaited her fish and chips with glee, but when her meal arrived, she carried on yapping away and then stared at horror as a plate of food flew off the table onto the floor. Her uncle Peter witnessed this and has reminded her of it ever since, for over 20 years. Other things about Stephanie that stand out include me waiting for hours for her outside Primark and New Look. As well as her dislike of geography, she has been known to call the Giant's Causeway just a pile of rocks. Finally, just before we toast Stephanie George, I think I meant to give them some advice about married life. Linda and I have been so impressed by the way they always looked after each other, so my advice is simply to carry on and your love will continue to grow and deepen over the years. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand and raise a glass to Stephanie Moore. Right, okay. Thank you very much, Paul. Did that come out?
Yeah.
Right,
cool. Right, now everyone knows this man here who's got the next speech. This is George Holden. Do I need to introduce him?
Thank you to Seb for introducing me, thank you to Paul for such a wonderful speech. I don't think mine will be quite as funny, but it must be good. So good afternoon, everyone. It's wonderful to be here today and for Stephanie and I to start our married life together, surrounded by those we love. As Father Andrew often reminds me, I'm a very lucky man. And as he often ends that statement, Steph is a brave woman. In the words that my cousin Alex advised me to use yesterday, on behalf of my wife and I. I would like to thank everybody for joining us. Thank you to everyone who has supported and encouraged us. And this has been in every thoughtful message, wedding acceptance, gift, and conversation we've had both today and in the weeks and months that preceded today. To our families who have put up with us down the years, and our parents who have always been there for us. Even the times where I'm sure they'd rather be anywhere else. And to our friends, who have helped us relax and have some fun along the way.
Hey.
It's been almost 5 years since Steph and I met. It was at a house party at university that this gorgeous, amazing woman sat next to me. And thanks to the wine brought along by Mr. Matt Lee, she decided to say hello. And thank Teddy Edwards as well. For not only was it Teddy's 21st where we met, but Teddy, who encouraged me to go along to the Teze prayer evenings early that summer. These beautiful prayers, one of which we heard during our nuptial mass, led me to visit the Teze community early that summer. And it was all these things which supplemented my cheesy pickup lines and made it sound both decent and interesting. Cheers, Teddy, I really owe you, buddy. Shall I give the mic to somebody else? Ah, woo! To you too! One of our first dates was to a fun fair. Little did I know it, but this beautiful woman would one day become my wife. I also didn't know then, but she was terrified of rides. And so not knowing this, I encouraged her to go on the most intimidating ride there. For some reason, she said yes. Aww. We're still getting to know each other. She would definitely say no now. And since then, Steph's organised much more civilised dates, including afternoon tea at the Orchard Ales, and going to the cinema. Wait till she sees the bungee jumping activity on the honeymoon cake. As well as marrying Steph, I'm marrying into her family, as she is into mine. It is a blessing to be joining such a welcoming, funny and kind family. and every family member of mine has recognised both how lovely Steph is and how lucky I am to be with her.
Yeah.
And I've had messages to that effect throughout the day. It was at a family event, the wedding anniversary of Stephanie's auntie and uncle, David and Pauline, if that is their real names, where I asked Paul for his blessing for Stephanie's hand in marriage. And thankfully, he said yes. Today, just over a year and a half later, Paul has walked Stephanie down the aisle, and she looked radiant, and Paul looked so proud. So thank you, Paul, for raising such a radiant woman. Thank you, Paul and Linda. Steph has today become my wife. But for the last 5 years, and you're stuck with me. I made that joke too early on. But for the last 5 years, you've also been my best friend. Not only is my life better with Steph, but with her, I'm a better man. Just turn the page. And I hope that I'm always the same for her. Both the good times are better, and the tough times are less hard. We also talk a lot. In fact, whilst I studied abroad in Texas, our marathon Skype calls became infamous. When my roommate Dave finally met her, he knew her voice so well, it was like a reunion of old friends. Today we are blessed to be surrounded by family and friends. Steph's bridesmaids are a symbol of how friends are loved like family, and family are as close as friends. They all looked wonderful, the bridesmaids today, and the day would have lost a lot of its magic without you here today supporting Steph and being alongside. Thank you very much. You looked very beautiful. To my groomsmen, my old friends, my good friends, thank you. You've been there for me all down the years. It's crazy thinking back how far we go, but there's some pictures there that prove it. And I'm lucky to have such good friends. And I couldn't be, and I wouldn't be the man I am today if it wasn't for knowing you. Seb, you have been an outstanding best man. Not only were we writing our speeches last night, we organised a blinder of a stag. And a card thank you for how you've gone about things with so much dedication, effort and good humour. You've been a best man for all this and for more. And thank you so much for everything. So cheers. So thank you to everyone, but a final thank you to our parents. We love you so much, and today would not have come together without you. You're examples of how to be, and I hope Steph and I will be as hospitable and charitable as we've experienced from our own parents. I look forward to our shared life together, and I'm immensely grateful for all of this. This beautiful venue, this sea of smiling faces, our nuptial mass and my amazing wife. Thank you to everyone who has made this possible, and there's been so many of you today, and everyone I've spoken to has made my day so much better just for being here and for supporting me and Steph. So I hope you've had a lovely day. So my first toast is to my beautiful wife. Second toast is for all those who have been involved in helping out today, and that's been quite a lot of you. There's been the readers today, there's been the page boys, thank you Andrew and James, did a great job, and Andrew for making us all smile in the photograph, so a big thank you to you too. our music group who made the Nuptial Mass today so beautiful.
Yeah.
To Adam and Chloe, who wrote the bidding prayers that we enjoyed and heard today. And being a model of how to be a married couple and to love and live so effortlessly. It's a And to all of the priests that married us today, thank you so much. So a toast to everyone who's helped out today. And thank you for all of you. And the last and final toast before I let you hear the best man's speech. No pressure there, sir. Enjoy. I'll commit the last toast if you want. You're doing a great job. But yeah, my last and final toast is the family. Me and Steph are both really deeply rooted in our family, both our intimate family and our wider family. And it is so lovely to be surrounded by everyone here. It's lovely to have met Stephanie's family in the years and, you know, the time we've been together. So it's lovely being surrounded by both my old family. Not that I'm getting rid of you. Hopefully you're not getting rid of me. And the family that I'm joining today as well. So to family and for everyone who's come such a long way. To family. And without further ado, could the best man not introduce himself? Here's the best man's speech.
Hey!
Right, so I'm Seb, and for those of you that don't know me, probably for the best, to be honest. I don't want to have me on the top table, I know that. Unfortunately, too much of the bright idea of asking me to be his best man, so good luck with that. Well, right, and I'll happily admit as well that writing our speeches night before the wedding probably wasn't the greatest thing. It's working so far. There's got a few years left of it. But yeah, so I haven't been to too many weddings before, and so I asked my mum, what should I do on the speech? She said, well, think of all the stories you've got with Joy, and I thought, fantastic, loads. And then she said, get rid of all the inappropriate ones. And basically, yeah, I was stuck. So this is what I blame my mum for the speech being written so late. Right, so this is what happens when you scribble on a piece of paper. I can confirm that there are no stag stories from the in this speech, which disappoints some, I imagine, but pleases others, I imagine. So. I've known George for about 17 years, and it hasn't always been this romantic a relationship. We've had our tough times, and the first major domestic I can really remember was Sermon Cup Camp, where I believe it was my birthday, wasn't it? And I got given a cake with a candle in it, and it was a really nice little cake, really nice candle and everything. And George, with his cake envy, decided he didn't want me to have this cake. Somehow, a bruised head and a flawed cake later, there was no cake there. So, that kind of gives an idea of our grounding as well. But, yeah, so after cake gate, we decided that food wasn't really our strong, like, responding like...
Well, thanks for not returning the favour today, Seth.
I'm sure Steph would have been happy. Get you back one day, but no. So anyway, after Cape Gate, we decided that games should be our next thing. So we thought, you know what, Mario Kart, FIFA, Champions and Nora, the usual games that friendships get destroyed over. And I'm pretty sure that we spent all of our time that we're supposed to be revising for our GCSEs completing Halo 3 on Legendary. This is already a disaster, so it's going to be even worse. I mean, the one thing that George can always rely on, above drunken antics, above, what else have I written, calamity, is his timekeeping, which I'm pretty sure all of you know about George's timekeeping and issues there. So I mean, back in our St. Bernard's days, it would be a regular occurrence that we'd meet up in town and just wander around Maidenhead town centre several times with various different friends. George would say, let's meet outside somewhere at this time. We'd meet up, except George wouldn't be there. George, we'd call him up an hour after he was supposed to arrive. He was still enjoying his famous leisurely bubble baths. I mean, you'd think his timekeeping issue would have been solved in the next 10 or 15 years. Who left their phone on? Right, so, yeah, you would think that. Anyway. 10 or 15 minutes later, you think George's timekeeping for a problem may be sorted out. But there's a little story from a couple of months ago where George was supposed to be attending a wedding of his friend Andreas. His wedding was in June, and Hilda, I believe you're quite well versed with this story. George thought the wedding was in July. And so, with the help of Hilda, he somehow managed to make it down from Leeds to London in the space of, was it a few hours or something? With, I believe, you on the phone looking up train lines and everything. And yeah, so he made it there by the nick of his teeth. But I think that that is a story that pretty much sums up George. Like, you know, no biggie, it's just a wedding. Like,
sorry, Andreas and Paula.
Right. So, I'm not really mentioning any of George's good qualities here. I should probably have been a little bit fairer. This guy whose heart is bigger than any person's I know, if I'm being honest. Like, sorry guys, like, nothing. There are stories of him helping those in need, going above and beyond what is expected, and of course, sitting and waiting all night outside Greek police cells for some of his friends. I mean, there is one story, I really want to share with you guys, and from our trip to Latvia back in January 2016, and it sticks in my mind despite the numerous sambucas and tequilas beforehand. You feeling nervous?
Right. I can't remember that night.
<You're> surprised.
Sorry,
as we stumble from one bar to another, carnage and destruction in our wake, George stopped me and he said, Seb, I've just thought, we're in an amazing city and surrounded by stunning women everywhere, so look where we look. He paused and he looked rather pensive. And he continued, but you know what? I know that Steph is the only woman for me.
Aww. I believe that would turn out.
Okay. host, which is, hang on, let me work out the ordering. Obviously to Steph, that was the natural order of this. How beautiful she looks, and to be honest, for organising this wedding, because we all know that George is probably more of a hindrance than a helper. Can you all join me in raising a glass to the beautiful bride, Steph? Yay! Yeah. My second toast is for the many people that couldn't be with us here today for various reasons. There's a lot of people that mean a lot to the bride, the groom, everyone else here. A lot of the other attendees know that people can't be here. And so, for that reason, can we raise a glass to loved ones? To loved ones. Right, now we're going off script, because this is all scribbles. Right, the final toast I have is arguably the most important. And so, for everything that's really gone on, can we all raise a glass to the barman? And join me in toasting to Mr. and Mrs. Holder. Right, now I guess everyone can go to the bar.
He's very good at fiction, is he? So we have a couple of small gifts to give out. The first one is to our parents. So we'll give one at a time. They've been amazing in organising and helping us with everything. The last year and a half has been a planning episode from all six of us in this team, so thank you so much. So the first gift now is from Linda and Paul. Thank you so much. You forgive me a lot of speech already. I'm still slow. And also to my own parents, to Jonathan and Hilda. Thank you for everyone. You look great today. We've got a few extra gifts. This is paid for these. Yeah. So, James and Andrew, are we going to put that across? Or? Just a second. So they would be impossible if it wasn't for James and Andrew. So here's a cheers to them. And we've got a small little gift with a teddy bear and each of their pictures on the cover. Aww. Andrew, would you like a few words? Or? For the five bridesmaids today, you looked absolutely gorgeous, and it was a great hen do that Steph had beforehand, and it was great to be surrounded by people she loves and cares so much for. So we've got some more little gifts for you as well, so thank you very much. To Catherine. Seth had very thoughtful and lovely gifts. I've got slightly strange gifts, so I'll give those ones out. Actually, Seth, I'll give yours first, and then it's for you, for Hamish, if you want to come forward, and for James. So my my groomsman, my best man. It is a strange gift.
What is it?
It's a useful gift. It's an umbrella with a samurai handle. So it becomes a useful umbrella. So, yeah. So that's it for this part of the afternoon. We're starting our first act at 7:30, and in the meantime we just have time to sort of relax and talk, and we can, you know, hang out here in the garden. And so I hope you have a lovely rest of the day, and thank you all for being such an attentive audience and such a forgiving audience, hopefully, as well.
Mr. and Mrs. Holder for their first dance.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I could try for your heart. Our dreams, and they are made out of real things, like a shoebox of photographs with sepia tone loving. Love is the answer, at least for most of the questions in my heart. Why are we here and where do we go, and how come we're so hard? It's not always easy, and sometimes life can be deceiving. I'll tell you one thing, it's always better when we're together. It's always better when we're together. Stars when we're together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. And all of these moments just might find the way. My dreams tonight, but I know that they'll be gone. It seems it brings me to things. It's hard to see that they'll be gone too. Too many things I have to do. But if all of these dreams might find their way into my day-to-day scene, I'd be under the impression I was somewhere in between, with only two, just me and you. Not so many things we got to do. Places we come to be, we sit beneath the mango tree. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. We're somewhere in between together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. Ain't I win? And when I wake up,
This evening is a little dance called the Gay Gordons. We will show you what to do.
Thank you. are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without price from the fountain of the water of life. He who conquers shall have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. The word of the Lord.
Cari fratelli e sorelle, buongiorno. Abbiamo ascoltato la parola di Dio nel libro dell'Apocalisse e dice così: ecco, io faccio nuove tutte le cose. La speranza cristiana si basa sulla fede in Dio che sempre crea novità nella vita dell'uomo, crea novità nella storia, crea novità nel cosmo. Il nostro Dio è il Dio che crea novità, perché è il Dio delle sorprese. Non è cristiano camminare con lo sguardo rivolto verso il basso, come fanno i maiali lì, sempre vanno così, senza alzare gli occhi all'orizzonte, come se tutto il nostro cammino si spegnesse qui, nel palmo di pochi metri di viaggio, come se la nostra vita non ci fosse nessuna meta e nessun approdo, e noi fossimo costretti ad un eterno girovagare senza alcuna ragione per tante nostre fatiche. Questo non è cristiano. Le pagine finali della Bibbia ci mostrano l'orizzonte ultimo del cammino del credente, la Gerusalemme del cielo, la Gerusalemme celeste. Essa è immaginata anzitutto come una immensa tenda dove Dio accoglierà tutti gli uomini per abitare definitivamente con loro. E questa è la nostra speranza. E cosa farà Dio quando finalmente saremo con Lui? Userà una tenerezza infinita nei nostri confronti, come un padre che accoglie i suoi figli che hanno a lungo faticato e sofferto. Giovanni nell'Apocalisse profetizza: ecco la tenda di Dio con gli uomini. Egli, cosa farà Dio? Egli asciugherà ogni lacrima dai loro occhi e non vi sarà più la morte, né lutto, né lamento, né affanno, perché le cose di prima sono passate. Ecco, io faccio nuove tutte le cose. Il Dio della novità. Provate a meditare questo brano della Sacra Scrittura, non in maniera astratta, ma dopo aver letto una cronaca dei nostri giorni. Dopo aver visto il telegiornale o la copertina dei giornali dove ci sono tante tragedie, dove si riportano notizie tristi a cui tutti quanti rischiamo di assuefarci. E ho salutato alcuni da Barcellona. Quante notizie triste di là. Ho salutato alcuni del Congo. E quante notizie triste di là. E tante altre, per nominare soltanto due di voi che siete qui. Provate a pensare ai volti dei bambini impauriti dalla guerra, al pianto delle madri, ai sogni infranti di tanti giovani, ai profughi che affrontano viaggi terribili e sono sfruttati tante volte. La vita purtroppo è anche questo. Qualche volta verrebbe da dire che è soprattutto questo. Può darsi. Ma c'è un padre che piange con noi. C'è un padre che piange lacrime di infinita pietà nei confronti dei suoi figli. Noi abbiamo un padre che sa piangere, che piange con noi. Un padre che ci aspetta per consolarci, perché conosce le nostre sofferenze e ha preparato per noi un futuro diverso. Questa è la grande visione della speranza cristiana, che si dilata su tutti i giorni della nostra esistenza e ci vuole risollevare. Dio non ha voluto le nostre vite per sbaglio, costringendo se stesso e noi a dure notti di angoscia. Ci ha invece creati perché ci vuole felici. È il nostro Padre. E se noi qui ora sperimentiamo una vita che non è quella che Egli ha voluto per noi, Gesù ci garantisce che Dio stesso sta operando il suo riscatto. Lui lavora per riscattarci. Noi crediamo e sappiamo che la morte e l'odio non sono le ultime parole pronunciate sulla parabola dell'esistenza umana. Essere cristiani implica una nuova prospettiva, uno sguardo pieno di speranza. Qualcuno crede che la vita trattenga tutte le sue felicità nella giovinezza e nel passato e che il vivere sia un lento decadimento. Altri ancora ritengono che le nostre gioie siano solo episodiche e passaggere e nella vita degli uomini sia iscritto il non senso. Quelli che davanti a tante calamità dicono: ma la vita non ha senso, la nostra strada è il non senso. Ma noi cristiani non crediamo questo, crediamo invece che nell'orizzonte dell'uomo c'è un sole che illumina per sempre. Crediamo che i nostri giorni più belli devono ancora venire. Siamo gente più di primavera che di autunno. A me piacerebbe domandare adesso. Ognuno risponda nel suo cuore, in silenzio, ma risponda. Io sono un uomo, una donna, un ragazzo, una ragazza, di primavera o di autunno? La mia anima è in primavera o è in autunno? Ognuno si risponde. Scorgiamo i germogli di un mondo nuovo piuttosto che le foglie ingallite sui rami. Non ci culliamo in nostalgie, rimpianti e lamenti. Sappiamo che Dio ci vuole eredi di una promessa e instancabili coltivatori di sogni. Non dimenticate quella domanda. Io sono una persona di primavera o di autunno? Di primavera che aspetta il fiore, che aspetta il frutto, che aspetta il sole, che è Gesù, o di autunno che è sempre con la faccia guardando in basso, amareggiato. E come alcune volte ho detto, con la faccia dei peperoncini all'aceto, no? Così. Dio il cristiano sa che il regno di Dio, la sua signoria d'amore, sta crescendo come un grande campo di grano, anche in mezzo se la cizagna, no? Sempre ci sono problemi, ci sono le chiacchiere, ci sono le guerre, ci sono le malattie, ci sono dei problemi, ma il grano cresce e alla fine il male sarà eliminato. Il futuro non ci appartiene, ma sappiamo che Gesù Cristo è la più grande grazia della vita, è l'abbraccio di Dio che ci attende alla fine, ma che già ora ci accompagna e ci consola nel cammino. Lui ci conduce alla grande tenda di Dio con gli uomini, con tanti altri fratelli e sorelle, e porteremo a Dio il ricordo dei giorni vissuti qua giù. E sarà bello scoprire in quell'istante che niente è andato perduto, niente, neppure una lacrima, niente è andato perduto. Nessun sorriso e nessuna lacrima. Per quanto la nostra vita sia stata lunga, ci sembrerà di aver vissuto in un soffio e che la creazione non sia arrestata al sesto giorno della Genesi. La creazione non è finita al sesto giorno, ma ha proseguito instancabile perché Dio si è sempre preoccupato di noi. Fino al giorno in cui tutto si compirà, nel mattino in cui si estingueranno le lacrime, nell'istante stesso in cui Dio pronuncerà la sua ultima parola di benedizione. Ecco, dice il Signore, io faccio nuove tutte le cose. Sì, il nostro Padre è Dio delle novità e Dio delle sorprese. E quel giorno noi saremo davvero felici? Piangeremo? Sì, ma piangeremo di gioia. Grazie.
To witness that I, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
To witness that I, Stephanie Maria Barnes.
Do take thee, George William Holder.
Do take thee, George William Holder.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
Sickness and health.
Sickness and
health.
Let no one